This August 11th, 2021, hallelujah, I just feel the strong presence of the Lord in our midst, Prince of Peace Ministries International. And of course, I'm yours truly, Apostle Joel, at your service. And we're looking into Matthew chapter 22. There are a few verses that caught my attention as it was earlier read, and we're going to look at them right now. The first verse that really took my attention was Matthew chapter 22, verse 14. Very simple. For many are called, but few are chosen. 8 words. For many are called, but few are chosen. I want to tell you this, one and all, that this choice was not made when the call went out. This call, this chosen, the chosen, were not chosen when the call went out. When people were invited to come. That's not when people were chosen. They're chosen from eternity past. We are human. We're here one moment, we're gone the next. But the Lord God of heaven, the Creator, the King of glory, the Lord of hosts, He is from everlasting, throughout time, to everlasting. That's when He chose us. Because He's everywhere at the same time. It's a hard concept for humans to grasp, but it really doesn't matter what humans grasp. This is the truth. The truth is, He is from everlasting to everlasting. There is no beginning, there's no ending. It's hard for humans to understand this, but this is the reality of the God of heaven. So He makes His choices before He even made time. So we're chosen from before the foundation of the world. This needs to be clear, because we're going to see that Jesus, Yahusha, the world calls Him Jesus. That's all right, because God understands English. Yahushua, Jesus, was misunderstood by religious leaders that were not interested in the souls of people. We're going to see this a little later in this chapter. And so they tried to trick Him. And this is another thing that really caught my attention. Let me get into it right now, because I think this is where the Spirit of the Lord is really propelling me in this direction. All right. So verse 15 says, "Then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle Him in His talk." You are going to entangle God as man. Because He's talking to you as a human? Not happening. But these people, they thought they could. Why? Because they thought He was too simple to be the Messiah. How mistaken they were. Anyway, in verse 16, they sent unto Him their disciples with the Herodians. The Herodians are people that followed King Herod of Galilee. All right. And they said, "Master, we know that Thou art true and teacheth the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the persons of men." Now, what does this tell you? This tells you that there are people that will observe true men and women of God. I don't care about the hypocrites right now. I'm not dealing with false preachers, because there's many of them out there. I'm talking about when you are chosen by God and you're doing the work of the Lord, somebody can see your value. They can see your integrity. They will know what you stand for. They know that you don't play around and that you're serious, and they'll hate you for it. And they'll come, and what they'll do is, if they know that you're wise, they're not going to come into your face and go on like you are an irritant to them. They will try to flatter you. And King Solomon had said in the Proverbs, "A flattering tongue worketh ruin." Be careful of people that flatter you. If they're telling you the truth, well, that's fine. Even though what they did with Jesus, they were setting Him up for a fall, they were coming with the truth, because they knew Him and they observed Him and they studied Him. And that's what Satan does. He studies you. All right? He's looking for a crack in the armor, and he's always coming at you. But God won't let Him come at you all the time. But He's always coming at you. I hope you understand what I'm saying. He's got you in his mind, and he's only one entity, by the way. He uses many demon lords. The whole world is divided up in the kingdom of darkness, and he has his crony demons observing you. So what they do is they observe you, and you are their mission. And what they're there to do is trap you. So just like King Herod and the scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees sent people to get Jesus, Satan will send demons in people to get at you. And you have to understand this. And if they don't get you personally, there's the internet. And if they don't get you through the internet directly, they'll get you through the internet, because the internet is everywhere. It comes right into your bedroom. It's a pipeline that comes right through the doors. Okay, right into you, where you are. So they can find you. And Satan can find you in the wilderness, and he'll find you on the internet. Hallelujah. And he's going to come and try to trick you. Why? So that he can get at your weakness. Why? So that he can get you to sin. Why? So that he can accuse you. And if he accuses you right, then he brings up his case. Why are you even dealing with this person? I deserve the right to tempt that person. They sinned, and I'm asking you to remove your protection from that person right now. Satan knows why he's accusing us. He's accusing us because he wants God to give up on us. Do you understand? You have to understand Satan, because he understands you. And if you don't get this, if you don't understand that he knows your carnality, because you've been observed from the moment you came out your mother's womb, so the enemy knows you just like they knew Jesus. They studied him. Point people, we know that you don't stand for foolishness. We know that you deal with truth and you're no liar. We know that you have no respect of persons. We know. They studied him. That didn't change their motives, but they studied him. Satan will study you. He's very patient. He wants all the knowledge, and he only gets knowledge from observation. All right, so he sets his demons on you, and they will study you, and they'll tempt you here, and they'll come at you here to see where you're strong and where you're weak. So they get all the information. Now they'll know how to attack. Now, why am I saying that? Because they attacked Jesus. So if they attack God in human form, what do you think is going to happen to you? They will attack. And they'll always come at you with talk. Isn't that what happened in the Garden of Eden? Absolutely. There was Eve talking with the devil. And the devil won't change. He'll change you though. So what you have to do is monitor the words that are spoken. Because you'll see a friendly face. You'll hear nice talk. You'll hear flattering words about you. But the motive, that's hidden. But you can detect it if you are alert. And if the Spirit of the Lord is within you, the Lord will open your eyes. So watch this. Verse 17, they gave themselves away. Tell us therefore, what thinkest thou? Seeing that you are true and you teach the way of God, and you don't care about who man, whether they're the king or a beggar on the street, you don't have respect of anyone when it comes to the truth. All right, so tell us, Lord, because you're the authentic, real thing. Is it lawful to give Caesar tribute or not? Because through their observation, they heard people saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. And they were saying, this is the king, this is the son of David. All right. So now they see that, and they did not like that, because they don't want to acknowledge that Jesus is the king of the Jews and he's the son of God. And so they were challenging him. So if he said, no, it's not good to give Caesar tribute, then they can say, oh, so you're going up against the state. Let's take him to Pilate. If he says, yes, give unto Caesar, then they can turn around and say, oh, so you're not the king of the Jews, because the king doesn't give to another king. You're an imposter, and you are not our Messiah, because the Messiah is going to rule over all nations. See, so they thought that they had him. Are you hearing me? Listen, people will think that they have you if they give you a flattering word about you, and they come to you sneakily. But let me tell you, if God gives you that gift to discern, don't be fooled by the nice talk, because they're setting you up. I know that God is speaking to someone right now. I know. Hallelujah. Because I got the Holy Ghost. Listen carefully. Do not fall prey to a flattering tongue, because it is there to ruin you. Are you hearing me? You put people through the filter of the Word of God. How are you going to know what's true or false, good or evil, right from wrong? By the fruit. That's how. That's how you can tell motive. By the fruit. What comes out, that's what defiles them. What comes out can tell you if you're dealing with a good person or a bad person. And when you see inconsistencies, that's bad fruit. So you mark that. Hallelujah. If God is opening your eyes, so be it. So be it, because there's many people out there today that is posing as truth and they're not. Now, it's not to say that those that are true are faultless. No. But the Lord is working on us who are true. And what we do when God shows us our faults, we transform so that we can go on with Jesus. Because we're always changing. We're always morphing into the perfect image, even our Lord Yeshua, Mashiach, Jesus Christ. That is who we want to be like. All right, so they came to Jesus. Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? Verse 18, but Jesus perceived their wickedness. Let me tell you something. A lie, hypocrisy, that's wicked. All right, there's no two ways about it. Hypocrisy is wicked. And Jesus saw it, and he said, why tempt ye me, you hypocrites? You know, there's some people that believe that Jesus is love. You know, why can't you be like Jesus? Why do you have to be so tough? And why do you have to be so hard and blah, 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 ray, ray, ray? Jesus said, why are you tempting me, you hypocrites? Do you think that was soft? Do you think that was soft? No. He was calling a spade a spade. There are just some times where you just have to bring it forward. You just have to bring it out and deal with the case. Jesus had to deal with the case. Don't give me your sweet words. You're a bunch of hypocrites. That's what Jesus is saying. He said, all right, okay. Show me a coin, all right? Show me the tribute money. Did you see that? And this is in red. This is Matthew chapter 22, verse 19. Show me the tribute money. Hallelujah. And they brought unto him a penny. They could have given him a drachma, a shekel, a sesterce, whatever it could be. Actually, Roman money, not the shekel. Roman money. They could have brought him something more valuable. You see what they think of him? They brought him a penny. They didn't want him to walk away with anything substantial. Here's a penny. There you go. And he saith unto them, in verse 20, whose is this image and subscription? They say unto him, Caesar's. Then saith he unto them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's, the Most High. Give unto him what he desires. And we're going to go into that further in this discourse. All right. Verse 22 says, when they had heard these words, they marveled and left him and went their way. nothing to say. Hallelujah. Jesus knows how to read people's hearts. You trust him and the truth will come out. There's nothing hidden that shall not be revealed. And this is why when you find a fault within yourself, it is good to humble yourself before the Lord and pray and ask God to take it out of you. Because you don't want the Lord to say, why are you coming before me, you hypocrite? Take the beam out of your own eye before you can see to see the mote, and take the mote out of your brother's eye. Now, let's turn over to, let's go down to verse 35 of the same chapter, Matthew chapter 22. All right, I'm going to read it from verse 34. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. And one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? All right. Verse 37, Jesus saith unto him, Thou shalt love Yahuwah thy Elohim, the Lord thy God, with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. Huh. Verse 38. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. I want to talk about this for a little bit. And for further explanation, I want you all to turn with me to Philippians chapter 2. Now, before I tell you what verse, I want you to hear this word. The Lord said to the people, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. All right? Now, to love the Lord means to fear God and to keep his commandments. Is that right? The word of God is his commandment. The whole word of God. All of it. Not just the 66 books, but even the 14 books that were taken away out of it. In fact, they tell us that over 100 books were taken out of the actual Bible. Okay, we only have 66 that is commonly read today. But it was a whole lot more. Why? Because those that did these things, they wanted to extract from the Word of God and not to hide certain knowledge. However, God preserved these 66 plus the 14 books that they call the Apocrypha. These have been preserved so that people can know the way of the Lord, the commandments of God, and also know who the real Hebrews are, and also know that there's a heaven and there's a hell, and also know how to be saved. So if you want to be saved, you got to come before God as a sinner. You have to surrender your life to him. You have to repent of your sins. You have to be baptized in the name of Yeshua Mashiach, Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins. And also to identify your life with his death and burial. Your past life must be identified with his death and burial because he died for your sins. So therefore, you must be baptized in his name, identifying yourself with his death and burial. And you need to receive the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that he rose up from the dead with. You need to receive that. That's him coming back in you. All right? Okay. So that's God in you, Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's how you get saved. But not just to get saved. You have to continue in the grace of salvation until he comes. So the Lord will point out for you that which is wrong. And then when you see that which is wrong within yourself, you turn away from it. That is what God expects you to do. So you're not perfect. Don't hold on to that. And don't make that an excuse for sin. What you have to do is say, this is wrong. I'm convicted. The Holy Ghost is convicting me of this wrong that I have been doing all this time, and I will do it no more. And the Spirit of God will nudge you and let you know that's wrong. Put that away. Don't do that anymore. Don't speak that way anymore. Don't handle yourself in that mannerism anymore. And then he doesn't just leave you empty. He shows you what you now must put on. And you must strive to do that. So you make adjustments in your life. And that is loving the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. You're putting him first. You're denying your human nature. You're taking on the divine nature of Yeshua Mashiach, Jesus Christ, within yourself. Okay, so that's the first part. That's the first commandment. The second commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. Now, how do you do that? Well, in Philippians chapter 2, it says here, let nothing, in verse 3, let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, humility. Have a humble attitude, not pride, because pride comes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. King Solomon tells you that. So with lowliness of mind, meaning your motives have to be not one just of lofty achievement, but you have to have a character. You want to be like Jesus Christ. So with lowliness of mind, okay, let each esteem other better than themselves. Did you hear that? That is loving your neighbor as yourself. So when you are considering your neighbor, whomsoever that might be, especially of the household of faith, fellow believers, when you're considering them and their plight, whatever dilemma they might be, circumstance, situation, you put their needs above your own at that time. Okay, you look out for their benefit. You're there to serve them, so to speak. That is loving your neighbor as yourself. Let's continue. Verse 4, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Did you hear what the Apostle Paul said? Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. So this means you mustn't just think of yourself. You've got to think of other people as well as yourself, given the relationship that you're in. You understand? This goes for husband and wife, parents and children, brothers and sisters, other people, whomsoever it might be. You must think of them in the category given, as well as thinking about yourself. That is loving your neighbor as yourself. And if you do that, Jesus says, that's what the law and the prophets were all about. This is what I'm about, and this is what my disciples are about. So if you love me, keep my commandments. That's what Jesus said. So if a person says they love God and they hate their brother and they want to stab them in the back and they don't mean well for their brother or sister, their love is just talk. Okay? If they just care about themselves and your brother can go jump off a cliff somewhere, that's not the love of God. And the Lord's going to call people out on that. Circumstances in life will occur that will show up who you really are, because there's nothing hidden that shall not be revealed. So whatever gifting God has given you, talents, gifts, whatever, even substance, if you can give some of your time, give some of your energy, give some of your substance for someone else in need, if you can do that, you are fulfilling the royal law. If you're not doing it, stop talking about Jesus, because you're not following him. You are merely religious. And religion outside of Jesus Christ is vain. But a relationship with Jesus Christ is pure religion. And if you have a relationship with Yeshua Mashiach, Jesus Christ, you're going to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you're going to love your neighbor as yourself. And you will strive to do so. It doesn't all come all at once. You have to take it step by step. Process. The process requires that you do that just like a little baby becomes an adult, and it doesn't happen overnight. But there's growth involved. And as such, this is what you must strive to become. Because Yeshua is coming soon. And he expects us to be ready when he comes. And we see in the book of Matthew, he says, no man knows the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. He's just going to come. The angels don't know. Even he as a man didn't know. But my Father in heaven, he as the eternal spirit, the all-encompassing, the all-knowing, the all-powerful, the all-present, ever-present God, as the eternal God, he knows. So as a man, in himself, he didn't know. But the eternal part of himself, he knew. That's where he knew. That's why he said, I don't know, but my Father in heaven knows. And he also said, I and my Father are one and the same. So in his humanity, he didn't know. But in his divinity, he knew all things. So nobody can trick him. Hallelujah. He can talk to the sea and say, peace be still. And he can call Lazarus, come from the dead. And he can tell a blind person, your eyes are open, you can see. And he can say, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. And he's the one that says, Philip, have I been so long with you that you don't know me? If you see me, you see the Father. Why are you asking, show me the Father? You're looking for another person when all you have to do is look at me? I am the mask of the Father. I am what the Father looks like as a human being. If you see me, you see the Father. But he was 100% human. And even at the same time as being 100% God in his spirit. All right? Just understand that by faith. You may not comprehend it, but just believe it and you will understand. Believe that Yeshua, Jesus Christ, is the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, all at the same time. And in his humanity, he was limited to that which can be done on the plane. Why did I say limited? I said it because he wanted to do everything as a man so that he could partake with us, the children, who are human. So anything that Jesus did, we can follow him doing it. Hallelujah. Matter of fact, he said to his disciples, oh, wow, you're amazed at these things that I'm doing? You shall do these things and greater. So everything he did it as a man. Supernatural, but as a man. So we have the power to become sons of God. And when he comes back, we're going to be just like him. Do you understand this? Oh, my goodness. That's why you've got to walk away from sin. You've got to be like Jesus. You have to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And you have to love your neighbor as yourself. You can't settle for how you are. You've got to become more than that. You've got to become the Christ in you, because that's the missing factor of your being. That emptiness you feel, that nothing in this life can fill, that's a void that only God himself in you can ever satisfy. And God made man like that on purpose. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. This is Apostle Joel saying shalom to one and all. This is Matthew 22 with these few chapters, these few verses in this chapter that I want you to contemplate, listen over and over again. It is possible to live righteous and live holy. When God shows you your sins, You turn away from them, and he will fill it with the fruits of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, gentleness, faith, which means faithfulness, meekness, which is humility, and temperance, which is self-control. These are the fruits that the Lord is expecting us to excel in. That's what will please him. Because by your fruits, you will know who you are, and you'll know who other people are. You're going to see faults in yourself and in others, but if their motives are to please God and live for him and be like him, and if that's your motive, you're in the right place at the right time, with the right set of people, and you just move on from there so that you can please God. Because at the end of the day, he's coming back to judge each and every one of us. Shalom to one of all, one and all. God bless you. God keep you. God make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you shalom, peace for your hungry soul. For he that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled with the shalom, the peace of God. This is Apostle Joel signing off. Shalom.